Y'all will stand with me this morning. So we get a lot of
information that seems confusing, and I don't know, it's kind of like all over the map at times, but we do have particular state guidelines that are given to us. So we have a fortunate benefit of having that, you know, particular direction in the state of Texas and even in some of our counties. So let's remember to keep all these people up in prayer. That's a big, this is a big burden on them, you know. And man, I worked for the government for over 20 years. And being held accountable and responsible is just not one of those things that management and government likes to do. And so it produces at times a lot of confusion. And so let's just continue to pray and ask that God give them the vision that they should follow. So let's go to the Lord in word of prayer. Father, I want to thank you so much as we come to you in praise and worship. We praise your name. We lift up your name. We exalt your name because not of anything about us, but because of who you are and of everything that you've done for us. Lord, we are faced with a pandemic. Our government is faced with providing guidance and having administrative responsibility to give us guidance and to direct us on how we're supposed to live and continue to work and prosper and thrive in this environment. And Lord, I pray that you indeed give them a vision that would allow for the risk avoidance and at the same as much as possible, and at the same time to allow people to go back to work and to earn a living. Lord, we pray for those who are struggling financially, Lord. You know, this is just something that weighs on my heart because I know if I was in that situation, I would be climbing the walls. And Lord, I pray that you would be with these individuals and that you would provide opportunities for each and every one of them. I pray for the lost in the area. I pray that as they are faced with the physical virus or the threat of the physical virus, that, Lord, they come to realization of the spiritual virus that exists within each and every one of us, and that's sin, and that the only cure for sin is Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lord, we ask that you help us to communicate that to as many people as possible. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I've been born again.
when we begin to look at struggles or our own struggles within, and I'm talking about even as a, I'm talking about specifically as a believer. You know, a lot of times it depends on maybe, you know, how dramatic your conversion experience or how much a particular sin that we might have rules our life. There's times when we can be led to feel like that, you know, we really don't meet the qualifications that God, you know, might have. And I think that that's the challenge that we have to understand when it comes to God's truth, is that when we have truth, we see the things that strengthen and encourages us rather than those things that tear us down and the lies that will seek to destroy us. It's you know, when Jesus came to the end of the Sermon on the Mount, he was talking about obeying those things that he had said, and he was saying, you know, the one who hears my words and does my words are the one, you know, I liken him to a man who built his house on a rock, and the storms came and the winds blew and beat upon the house, and when it was all said and done, the house stood because it was built upon a rock. But the one who hears my words and does not do my words, I liken it to the man who built his house upon the sand, and the storms came and the winds blew, and the house was destroyed. Well, it's in that hearing aspect, it's in the understanding of truth that we have to come and realize what's real and what is a twisted or a mixture of truth. In other words, what's false, in order for us to work through some of the struggles that we have, and even the struggles with a particular sin that we might fight with. I've had the blessing of being able to go to a few of the AA meetings with Clay and Carissa, and the thing that gets me is the acknowledgement of I am an alcoholic. You know, I may not have drank for decades, but I'm an alcoholic. You know, that just brings to me is that acknowledgement, that ever-present acknowledgement is there about my own weakness, about my own inability. And sometimes we can let that weakness kick us back and take us back to where we don't think we're worthy of God. We can think, even if I fail and I fall, we oftentimes can believe that we can turn away from God's love, and then his love will turn away from us. And you see, there's nothing further from the truth than that. And the truths that we learn, the doctrines that we learn in the Word of God are foundations that we can stand on and that we can build our house on, so to speak, so that when the rains come and the winds blow and the storm beats against us, we can look down and realize that we're still standing, not because of anything we've done, but because we're standing on the rock. The doctrine that I'm talking about in particular is the doctrine of justification. We've heard it, you know, we've heard this, you know, the just shall live by faith, and we've heard many things in over the years about justification, and we may have a decent understanding of it, but one of the things, and I want to say that even in the church, especially in the church, this is probably one of the most misunderstood or misapplied doctrines or wrongly interpreted doctrines when you look back at church history that exists. It was exactly the doctrine that drove Martin Luther into starting the Protestant movement when he posted his 95 theses on that church door, and that's where it came out and said, the just shall live by, he told them the just shall live by faith, so we are saved by faith alone. And so I want us to look at this, and I want us to understand the aspects of what justification does for us, in order so that as we are bombarded with sin, as sin seeks to continue, and the demonic forces of this world continues to seek to steal, to kill, and to destroy who we are individually, I want us to understand that on God's truth, we have a sure foundation because of who God is, and not because anything that has to do with who we are. I'm going to ask you to turn with me, if you would, into Romans, the fourth chapter. Romans, the fourth chapter. Romans, the fourth chapter, beginning in verse 1. Romans chapter 4, verse 1, it says, "What then shall we say that Abraham our father has found according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the Scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Now to him who works, the wages are not counted as grace, but as debt. But to him who does not work, but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted for righteousness. Just as David also describes the blessedness of the man to whom God imputes righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord shall not impute sin." Let us pray. Father, I want to thank you so much for the fact that you justify us, not based off of anything we do, but based off everything Jesus is and who you are. Lord, I ask that you would be with us during this time as we seek to worship, to continue our worship of you in message. Help us to worship you in this way and to draw near to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So justification, what is justification? We see in scriptures, and we'll see as we go through this, that there are two aspects. There's the declared aspect of justification, and there's the demonstrated aspect of justification. First, when we look at the declared aspect, justification is a result of our faith. When we acknowledge and we see that we are in fact lost and helpless and hopeless in our sin, and we repent of our sin and turn to God, trusting in what Jesus Christ accomplished on the cross for us, we trust or we place our faith in Jesus at that point, that all of that is a result of regeneration. We go from regeneration to the conversion experience of repentance and faith, and then we go into justification. Justification is a result of faith. And we see a repentance and faith as a result of the conversion experience. So what does justification mean? What does that
get us down to. And that's where we see that there are things that are taken away from us and those things that are given to us. One of the things that are taken away is our sin, the accountability for our sins. It talks about blessed are those whose sins are forgiven. Our sins are no longer held against us. That's the same thing what was said in Colossians. When Jesus died on the cross, they took Jesus down off the cross, and the accountability of our sins remained on the cross. It remained. That's a part of justification. It is an act of God that declares us as no longer guilty of our sins. We are acquitted, if you will, of our sins. We're forgiven. That's what the Bible calls forgiveness. And also then, we see that not only are we forgiven of those sins that we have, but all of our sins are forgiven. You know, when I look at my life right now, I tend to break it down into past, current, and future. Or past, present, and future. I think to myself, oh man, my past, my sins are forgiven in my past. And a lot of times, I might hold my present and my future sins against myself. But what God says in His Word is that all of my sins have been forgiven. Amen. I'm no longer guilty. Amen. When Jesus died on the cross, guess what? All of my sins were future. All of our sins are future. So it doesn't give us license to sin, but what it does is it helps us understand that our salvation doesn't depend on our strict obedience. God says, Tim, I know you're a mess up. I know you're not going to get this right. Just know I'm not holding it against you. You know, you're still my son. You're still forgiven. And when you mess up, nothing's going to change. Again, that doesn't give me license to go do whatever it is I want to do. That's not how we are supposed to see it. Faith is supposed to be transformational. Justification is something, it's a declaration of our state of our being. It's not necessarily anything that causes us to change. What a surgeon does is, if I have cancer, is he goes in to seek to remove the cancer. What a judge does is more forensic. He tends to talk about my state or my being. So justification doesn't have anything to do with me being, you know, doesn't change me. It is a legal standing. My legal standing in front of God from now on is one where my sins are not held against me.
Amen.
Now, folks, I want you to know that this misinterpretation of this almost leads into salvation by works. As a matter of fact, Paul speaks quite heavily about faith is, or our salvation is by faith alone. As a matter of fact, during the time of the Reformation of Martin Luther and all those folks following, the idea, the message or the call was faith alone. Faith alone is what saves us. That's our part, is, you know, and we talk about repentance is, and faith are, you know, two different sides of the same coin. But faith alone is what saves us. And what we're talking about is a work of God that He has done on behalf of us, and that is the say that we are no longer guilty of our sins. We are forgiven. Man, you know what we can do if we don't remember that is we can kind of allow ourselves to spiral out of control. Why? Because we keep going back to that point of you're not good enough. See, that's exactly right. We're not good enough. I mean, let's get real. There's none of us that earn God's salvation. None of us are good enough. And then when you look on the TV, you know, I said, you know, there's a whole lot of little cupcakes on the TV that demonstrate they're definitely not good enough. You know, as they're destroying cities and stuff like that. And you know, but that's an extreme case. You know, we have to look at our lives. We have to look at our children. And we can love our children. And man, I do. I do love my children. I love my grandchildren. And when I get great-grandchildren, I want to love them. But I realize each and every one of them are going to be guilty, and they are going to be unable and incapable of salvation on their own because they are never going to be good enough to be saved. But that is the point of justification. God declares us legally to be acquitted.
Amen.
And when I'm attacked, and when the things start coming against me, when sin and the demonic forces start working against me, they want to tear me down and say, man, you're not doing this good enough, you're not doing that good enough. And you know what? You're absolutely right. But that doesn't change the status of who I am in my Father's eyes. I'm still His son. I'm still acquitted and forgiven of all of my sins, no matter how stupid I can get sometimes.
Amen.
And you ever wonder why Jesus actually lived? You know, I mean, why wasn't He just born and crucified as a baby? You ever think about that? Well, He lived a life, you know, that when we see the incarnation, He had the human side of Him. And He lived a life that was righteous. Right? He actually created a vial, if you would, a righteousness. Look what the scripture says. In the bottom of verse 6, it says, I'm just going to read 5 and 6. So it says, but to him who does not work but believes on Him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted for righteousness, just as David also described the blessedness of the man to whom God imputes righteousness apart from works. Then if we jump over to 5:17, chapter 5, verse 17 in Romans, it says, for if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. The righteousness that Christ accumulated, if you would, in His humanity is what goes in our folder. The account of sins and the whole record of our sins gets cast aside, and what gets put in our folder, it is the account of Christ's righteousness. So if you go and look at and follow it as to what's imputed, so Adam sinned, and his sin was imputed to us, or was assigned to us, if you would. And then when Jesus died on the cross, the guilt of our sin was imputed to Jesus. And at the same time, for the believer, Jesus' righteousness is imputed to the believer. So that's a three-step process. It, you know, the sin goes from Adam to humanity, And then the sin of humanity goes to Jesus on the cross, and the righteousness of Christ goes to humanity. Amen. Amen. I mean, praise God, not only am I not just put in a neutral state, and, you know, I'm not just acquitted of my sin, but I'm also given a record and a file of righteousness that I had nothing to do with.
Amen.
Not only was I incapable of helping myself, but God gave me a record that is credited for me of things that I didn't even earn. Things that I didn't even do. Man, it's not only the stuff that he takes away, it's the stuff that he gives. That's part of justification. That's part of our legal standing. Not only are we acquitted of crime, but we're considered an excellent or superior citizen because of what Christ did for us on the cross. Isn't that awesome? That's a declared state. That's a legal standing. Guess what? There's nothing I can do to change that. Why? Because it is a declared state by God. And that's part of, and this is what we have to understand about doctrines, is how they tie together. And this is how we understand our eternal security. Because if God has declared me righteous, if he's declared me acquitted of my crimes and declared me righteous, then guess what? I can never lose that. Consequently, I can never lose my salvation.
Amen.
I can't blow it so bad that God says, get him out of here. That's big to me. That's a lot. And when we struggle with our own selves and within ourselves because of sin, what does sin want to do with us? Hey, the wages of sin is death. Just the natural process of sin is like a terminal cancer. It's destructive. And on top of that, we have the demonic forces that seek to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So they use our own sins against us. They use all this to tear us down and to try to destroy us. But God says, look, buddy, you stand on this rock right here. You stand when that storm hits you, when your mind is telling you things that you ought not be telling yourself. You stand on this truth that by faith you are justified and you shall live by your faith because I have declared you righteous.
Amen.
We aren't then told that we're not good enough. And that impact us. Because when someone tells me I'm not good enough, I say, you're absolutely right. Neither are you. But praise God, Jesus was. And it's his righteousness that I now have. It's his righteousness that I now have in my record. When God goes and looks at my life, what does he see? The righteousness of Christ. Isn't it? That's just crazy when you think about it. It blows my mind. God gives him my sin. He gives me his righteousness. Why? Because I love. They don't gain. You know, God doesn't gain anything. It doesn't make him a better God. It doesn't make him a different God. It doesn't make him more God. He just does it because he loves us. That's the I want us to, you know, I don't want to beat up the term relationship because it does have application, it does have meaning, but we have to understand that the doctrines of our faith form our relationship, they define our relationship. You say, well, what do you mean? Well, look, David and Goliath had a relationship. It wasn't a good one. It wasn't a co-promoting one. It was David and Goliath wanting to destroy each other kind of relationship. But it was a relationship. What defines my relationship with God are these things that we're talking about in justification. Who declared me righteous, his giving me a legal standing means that he loves me enough that he has acquitted me of my sins, and not only that, but he has provided righteousness. He didn't put me in the neutral zone. He went ahead and took me to the other side.
Amen.
And declared me righteous. So then what about the demonstration part? There's the declared side, and there's the demonstration side. And if you want to turn to it, you can. But over in James, this is the part that James talks about. And what James is describing is the difference between easy believism and real faith. Right? There's an easy believism that says, oh yes, I acknowledge there's a God. But there's a faith that is transformative. And that's when he says, you know, look, Abraham, well, let me read it for you. James 2, verse 18 through 24. James 2, 18 through 24 says, but someone will say, you have faith, and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that there is one God? You do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. But do you want to know, O foolish man, what faith without... But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect, and the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. You see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith. And this is more on the demonstration side. This isn't on the declaration side. How did Abraham demonstrate his justification? He believed God when God said, go offer Isaac on that mountain. He believed God would provide a substitute in place of Isaac, or that he would raise Isaac from the dead. He believed God would not break his promise because he had already been told by God that Isaac was the son of the promise. So Abraham demonstrated his righteousness by taking Isaac onto the mountain to offer him because he knew God would solve the problem that would be created. He had faith, ongoing faith. Abraham's original faith began, his conversion experience began back in the land of Ur when God said, hey, Abraham, wake up and go out to a place I'm fixing to show you. So Abraham packed up and he took off and God led him to the land of Canaan. Abraham believed God then, and that's the faith that was accounted to him in his conversion experience as righteousness. That was where he was declared legally righteous in God's eyes. But here, this demonstration of righteousness is when God offered him, or asked him to offer Isaac as a sacrifice. You see, God had already had all these conversations with Abraham, and it was like a whole bunch of years, you know, when Abraham, you know, before Abraham actually, or Sarah actually had Isaac, it was, you know, a few decades, and Sarah finally had Isaac, you know, man, I mean, you know, at the end of all that here, Isaac is, probably a young teen, and he's at least big enough to carry wood. And he goes and he says, I want you to offer this son as a sacrifice. Well, Abraham knew. Hey, God keeps his promises. God has already told me this is the son that the inheritance will come through. This is the son that many nations will be blessed through. This is the heir that will take everything that God has given to me and that will bless all nations through Isaac. So if I go and offer him as a sacrifice, God's got something in mind he has to have something in mind to keep his promise, because God's not a liar. So he demonstrated his righteousness in his obedience to God. Just like we demonstrate our righteousness by living a godly life. Because that's the faith that he's saying is the real faith, is one that is demonstrated by the life that's lived for God, as opposed to the demonic, the demons. And what's he say? Hey, James said, man, before I get into that, James was Jesus' brother. He grew up, he was a man before he believed Jesus was the Savior. He grew up, can you imagine having that older brother? Jesus never does anything wrong, that kind of thing, going in, always get, you're the one that gets your tail end busted, Jesus never gets in trouble, and so, James had, and when we preached through John, we saw there were moments of antagonism between the brothers and between Jesus. So he was a man when he came to faith in Jesus Christ. And he comes and he says, do you believe there's one God? You have intellectual assent that there's one God? Great. Guess what? The devils also believe and tremble. They know it too. We see that in the Gospels. What hast thou to do with us, O Son of God? Our time has not yet come. Can you believe they know they have a time coming and yet they're still rebellious? They don't even plead for mercy. They know who Jesus is, and when they're confronted with him, they don't believe, they don't even plead for mercy. And he's saying that kind of belief is not the saving faith. That's not the saving faith. He's saying the kind that ends up being demonstrated by a transformed life is saving faith. And there's a whole lot of people that don't have. There's some people that is a dramatic change in life. That change may be from here to here. And there are some that change may be from here to here, so to speak, when it comes to how a person is living their life. The outward appearance. But what goes on inside, or what goes on spiritually, is still the same. You're no less in legal right standing. If you're a good person and don't believe in Christ, you're in no less of being guilty of your sin and going to be held accountable of your sin than the person who is a serial killer out there. Both are still lost. Both are going to face judgment. So it is by faith that we are saved. It is by faith that we are justified, legally declared, acquitted or forgiven of sins, and declared righteous, but it is that transformed life because of regeneration that we demonstrate our righteousness in the way we live. It's the working of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God in our lives.
You see, there's the declaration and there's the demonstration. And not always do we get it right all the time. That's the big key, right? Praise God. It's a declaration. Because if it depended on me, I'm not going anywhere but down. As long as it completely depends upon God, I have a confidence, I have an assured confidence that it's going up.
Amen.
And that's what we see. See these things, they tie together, these truths, they tie together. Why? To give us a sure foundation. If I think I can lose my faith, guess what? When the storms of life come, I'm probably going to fall apart. But that's not what God's Word really teaches. What God's Word really teaches is that this is an act of God, and an act of God alone is a result of our conversion. It is a result of our faith. But it is an act of God, and once He's declared us righteous, there's no turning back. There's no changing. We may mess it up at times, and we're going to. But praise God, I can go back to Him and say, Daddy, I'm sorry. Forgive me. And the Bible teaches when we are willing to confess our sins, and God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. And that's what we come to. And we come to this point of justification. And I want to tell you that for those who don't have that, they are building their house on sand. They are on an unsure foundation. The way to get this, the way to get on the rock, is by placing our faith in Jesus. We talked about that in the previous sermons, that we have to identify and recognize the fact that we are indeed lost and without hope in our sins and our trespasses, and that God's wrath is justified when He pours it out on us eternally in judgment because we have not believed in Him. But, praise God, He sent His Son to take all of the sin and guilt and His wrath on Himself on our behalf, so that when we repent, when we turn from our sin and turn to God, we can place our faith in Jesus, and God, our Heavenly Father, will save us. That goes into, we will be born again, we will be justified, and we are adopted. We become truly His children. We become truly His children. And that's what we preached on last week. And folks, it doesn't end there. There's a process that we'll preach on next week called sanctification, where God's ongoing presence in our life and working in our lives.
Amen.
But right now, if you are without Jesus Christ, there's an opportunity for you to turn, to repent from your sin and place your faith in Jesus. You can do that right now. If you are an unbeliever, if you've not been saved, then you can get saved right now. When you feel the Holy Spirit working in your heart, that is the time to say, yes, I want to believe in Jesus. Now, if you're a believer, maybe you have some business you need to take care of with God. You can absolutely do that however the Holy Spirit guides us, whether it's staying in the pew, coming to the prayer altar, whatever, you can do that. Just be obedient. That's just the whole idea of rededicating your life. And hopefully everybody is confirmed by the Holy Spirit, hey, you're doing good. You're doing good. Keep going. You know what? Hey, if not, take care of it.
Don't hold back. I'm going to ask Serena to come forward. We're going to have the word of prayer. And anyone who wants to make a decision can make that decision for Jesus Christ, whatever that is. And we can, we'll receive you and we'll pray with you and we'll continue on in we'll encourage you, whatever decision that is. I'm going to have a word of prayer, and then we're all standing and saying, Father, I want to thank you so much for the way that you have given us opportunity after opportunity after opportunity to receive your grace and mercy. Lord, I pray for any who are lost that you would save them, and for the Christians, I pray that all would draw nearer to you. Lord, if there are any believers here that need to get things right with you, Lord, I pray that you would take care of that, that your Holy Spirit would convict them of sin and of righteousness, and that they would respond in the affirmative and make those changes in their lives. Lord, I pray that for all those who are doing their very best to live godly lives for you, that your Holy Spirit would confirm that they're on the right track. Be with us now as we stand and we have this time of invitation in honor of Jesus. For it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Go ahead and sing.
Giving us a